Alright, it's time to do what every YouTuber does when they gain even a little bit of notoriety on the platform and talk about how much money I made doing it. Thanks to a few of my videos taking off, this channel has gained 100,000 subscribers and over 5.5 million views within a month. I hope it goes without saying that I am incredibly grateful to everybody who has watched my videos, subscribed, left an encouraging comment, or even pointed out an area where I can improve. But with that sappy bullshit out of the way, all regular viewers of the channel will know that I hate dragging out an answer to a simple question just to get you to stick around. So, $29,000. Now, there are some really interesting things here that I have discovered in this period of rapid growth, and some concerning trends which will likely mean that this gravy train is coming to an end very soon, not only for my channel, but for almost every channel on the platform. These big red flags are how revenue is actually generated by content creators, the proliferation of ads for questionable products, and the rise of alternative platforms. So it's time to learn how money works, to give you a behind the scenes look at this channel and how it made $1,000 a day, but also to make predictions about the future of this site as a whole. So the most obvious factor at play here is the rise of alternative entertainment platforms. For most of the last decade, YouTube has been unrivaled in the consumption of online video. Still to this day, it is by far the most popular entertainment platform in the world, but it's not the only option anymore. Paid services, open streaming platforms, alternative video sites, and even creator-dedicated services like Nebula, which are advertised by YouTubers who would have otherwise made content exclusively for, well, YouTube. These alternative outlets means that YouTube has lost a lot of its negotiating power in three distinct markets: the market for viewers, the market for creators, and of course, the market for the all-important advertisers. A content creator focused on video games would be split between YouTube and Twitch, and they could only really concentrate on growing their audience on one. A beauty influencer might pay more attention to Instagram or even TikTok, and even nerdy finance creators like myself might consider going after an audience on Facebook. We have all seen the headlines of major influencers being signed to a specific platform for massive sums of money, and this trend is likely to continue into the future. Remember that for later, because that is really important. In the same way, viewers have more choice in where they go to spend their afternoon, ignoring their responsibilities. Server hosting is only getting cheaper as technology improves, and giant companies are often not brought down by equally giant competitors, but rather by lots of small players that each compete in a specific niche better. Also, I know, YouTube revenue trends look like this, so maybe they will be able to balance out this new competition with the fact that more people are turning to the internet for a bulk of their entertainment. And look, this pressure is already having an impact. Whether you love them or hate them, YouTube has really pushed out a lot of new features in the past 5 years as they attempt to once again be the one-stop shop for video content. Streaming platforms release on-demand content, YouTube releases movie rentals. Twitch becomes a go-to hub for live streaming, YouTube releases their own streaming platform. TikTok turns into a global machine to turn talentless lip syncers into celebrities, and there is YouTube a few months later with YouTube Shorts. Even if the competition isn't hurting their bottom line yet, it's certainly keeping them on their toes, which is great. You might not love these features, but they are there if you decide that you do. And they probably wouldn't be there if it weren't for competition. Alright, let's get into what you're all here for. The money. So, the channel made almost $30,000, and there are a few key takeaways for how this was possible, but there are also a few things that I did terribly wrong. The first big mistake I make is giving away the answer at the beginning of every video, because YouTube rewards watch time above all else. If someone clicks on your video, the almighty algorithm wants to make sure that they are watching it for a long time. This is tracked as the average view percentage. How much of the video does the average person watch? This is an effective tool for weeding out the most egregious types of clickbait. If someone posts a video titled, "Kanye West challenges Mr. Beast to a rap battle," it would probably get a lot of clicks. It certainly hits all the right buzzwords. But if the video is an obvious troll, then people are only going to watch the first few seconds before clicking away or leaving the site altogether. YouTube really doesn't like this, because as soon as you leave the site, you are no longer a pair of eyeballs that they can charge advertisers for access to. So these videos with terrible average view durations get hidden. The opposite is also true. A video that makes everybody watch the entire way through is normally the sign that it is very entertaining, and if nothing else, it gives the site a longer chance to throw up a few more ads. This has become a new arms race. It's not good enough to get people to click a video. You have to keep on baiting them to watch longer and longer. The best way to do this is to make really engaging and entertaining content. Or, if that's too difficult, you can make the audience wait 7 minutes to see the result of an 8-second drag race. Whatever you do, don't give away what everybody clicked onto the video for right at the beginning of the video. But fuck it, be the change you want to see in the world, right? I hate it when videos needlessly drag out a simple question, so I'll be damned if I do it. This watch time arms race has also meant that there has been a consistent trend to make longer videos. So, if you want to make it on YouTube, you gotta learn to drag shit out a little bit. Or a lot. I have very much failed at this, for the same reason as before. If I can make my point in 10 minutes, I'm not taking 20 minutes to do so just to cram some extra mid-rolls in there. I know. What a dumbass I am.
I gotta pump those numbers up. Those are rookie numbers in this racket.
The final and potentially biggest mistake I made was paying to promote my content early on. Turns out, if you pay for a whole lot of ads to promote your videos, most people are only going to watch them for as long as they need to before that skip button comes up. The videos I initially paid to promote got tens of thousands of views, but only averaged around a 10% view duration. This meant that YouTube basically ranked them as complete trash, and would never organically recommend them to someone who might want to watch them rather than just being forced to watch them. This mistake was actually so bad that I had to entirely rebrand the channel. Only the real OGs will remember Compounded Daily. So, lesson learned, I guess. Organic growth beats paid growth every time. Now, despite all these teachable mistakes, there are a few things that I did right. I had a decent library of content before I started gaining a lot of views, which meant if a new viewer decided that they liked my content, they could go and watch a whole bunch of similar videos straight away. Had the channel taken off after I had only produced one or two videos, then new viewers wouldn't have had the opportunity to binge watch my content, which means less views overall, and it also means that the average views per viewer would be lower, which is another key metric that the YouTube algorithm looks for when deciding which channels to put in their recommended tabs. What this means is that if you are trying to build a channel, but are getting frustrated spending hours upon hours making video after video all to get no views, don't think of it as a failure. Think of it as piling up more wood so a fire can burn stronger once a flame actually does catch. Or, I don't know, maybe this is just survivorship bias. Who can say? The other thing that I did right was being an American content creator that primarily appeals to young American professionals that are highly sought after by advertisers. It is no secret that this particular content niche is lucrative on YouTube, and with a similar amount of views, my channel might make 5 times as much money as a gaming channel. But why is that? You might think it's because young professionals from America, the UK, and Canada have the disposable income to afford the stuff that advertisers are willing to pay top dollar to advertise, and that's certainly true. But there is another reason why finance channels make more money than almost any topic on YouTube, and it's the same reason why I really don't see this lasting much longer. The scams. There is a good chance that before watching this video, you were presented with an ad from some schmuck with a whiteboard telling you about how they have trained hundreds of students who are now making hundreds of thousands of dollars a month by forex trading, or automating Amazon, flipping houses, or whatever the bullshit flavor of the month buzzwords they can string together and try to convince you to buy their course. These scummy advertisers will target the shit out of finance channels because they know that the average person that watches these channels will be interested in business, but still at a place where they are only just learning about it. YouTube has been repeatedly in hot water for allowing this practice, but in their defense, it is difficult to vet every single advertiser that appears on the site, especially when they intentionally work in legal gray areas. It also gives YouTubers a difficult decision to make: turn on ads to get paid for the content they put a lot of time and effort into producing, or turn them off and rest easy knowing they haven't exposed their audience to these truly harmful practices. In the interest of full transparency, I keep the ads on. I hope to one day make this my full-time job, and while I made crazy money last month, it has already slowed down a fair bit, and it won't last me long at all if I were to turn these ads off. I just hope that my content does more good than harm in teaching people about what these sleazy salesmen are up to. What would be a fantastic solution to this problem is to give content creators the same kind of power to choose who can advertise on their videos as the advertisers have. Wishful thinking, maybe, but it would certainly help me sleep better at night. Now, if you are smugly sitting there with your ad blocker running, don't think that you are completely void of this problem. Sponsored ads, as in the ads that are read by the actual content creator, have become a lot more common, but they also bring with them a similar set of problems. My good friend Richard over at The Plain Bagel recently made a fantastic video about how he was offered $30,000 to promote a dubious crypto scheme on his channel. Now, Mr. Bagel obviously turned that down, but he admits himself that was not an easy decision to make. that could easily be more than some people make in a year, all for reading a script for 30 seconds and publishing it to the internet. The damage would be inevitably greater, because people inherently trust the personalities they subscribe to over some skippable ad at the beginning of their videos. I can report firsthand that since my channel has grown in popularity, the business email that I set up for the channel has been hammered with similar requests. But I have made a decision. Obviously, I would never work with an advertiser that is an outright scam, but I have also decided not to work with any advertisers that I don't personally use myself. So, no VPNs that promise to act as a virtual rubber protecting your precious data, spoiler alert, that's not what VPNs do, no free-to-play games that inevitably slap you with endless microtransactions, and fucking nothing to do with any fucking companies peddling anything to do with crypto bullshit. Instead, I am just going to promote my channel membership and my Patreon. Both are exactly the same. They both cost $2 a month, and they both have access to the same perks, an extra video every month, 24 hours early access to all the new videos I make, and the ability to vote on what topics I explore in the upcoming month. Pick whatever one you like if you think that this is worth it. If you don't, that's totally fine. But hopefully, this will allow me to spend the time and effort I would have otherwise wasted dealing with the demands of sponsors, and use it instead to create some extra content for the people who really enjoy it. In a perfect world, this would let me quit my job and focus on creating videos full-time with the assurance that the whole thing won't come crashing down when YouTube is inevitably forced to kick out scammers off their ad program. And if you're thinking to yourself, hang on, did this guy just subtly flex about making 30k in a month while asking for more money all at the same time in a 12-minute video? Yes, yes I did. Welcome to YouTube, you must be new here.
It's his first day on Wall Street, give him time.
Now, go watch my video on how those Amaze giveaways work as little more than thinly veiled casinos with terrible odds. It's a win-win. I get higher average views per viewer statistics, and you get to partake in the torpedoing of any last hope I had of getting a sponsor on this channel. Enjoy! Oh, and for a slightly less sarcastic video next week, make sure to like and subscribe to keep on learning how money works.